DNA is what they call the molecule of life. It carries the genetic code of an organism. And we're interested in the structure. And the structure of DNA is a right-handed double helix, where each one of the strings that form the helix is made of a sugar group and a phosphate group alternating sugar, phosphate, sugar, phosphate, sugar, phosphate. And that's called the backbone. To each sugar phosphate group is attached a nitrogenous base, just call it a base. And the bases in the two backbones pair A with T and C with G, and they are held together with hydrogen bonds. For each turn of the helix, so this would be a full turn of the helix, you will expect to have 10.5 base pairs per turn in what we call BDNA. And it's important to note that it is right-handed for the DNA that is in most organisms. If we put the DNA of all the chromosomes in the human genome together, we have more than 3 billion base pairs. 3 billion base pairs of DNA measure approximately 2 meters. All that DNA fits in one very small cell that is 10 micrometers in diameter. Every cell in your body has 2 meters of DNA in it. And you can imagine then what an important problem it is to package this DNA in such a way that is easily accessible for all the cellular transactions, and at the same time that it doesn't overflow or put too much stress on the cell because of the sheer amount of genetic material in there. So in my case, I like to study the geometrical and topological properties of DNA. So even though we are able to model DNA in all its atomistic detail, so going atom by atom and looking at forces and interactions, we're not so much interested in that. We're interested in looking at DNA as either a ribbon or just as a curve. When we model DNA as a curve, we're talking about the curve drawn by the axis of the double helix. So this DNA molecule will be modeled as just a curve that is properly embedded in three-dimensional space. So we can model DNA in the atomistic detail, or we can look at it from further away and model it as a ribbon where each one of the sugar phosphate backbones is one of the boundaries of the ribbon. So you will have a boundary curve that is blue and a boundary curve that is red. Still, the axis of the ribbon is this pink curve. And the advantage of modeling it as a ribbon is that then you can measure the torsion of this DNA molecule as it rides in space and as it's packaged in an organism. If you just model DNA, so you go further down in the level of resolution, and you model DNA as a single curve that does not self-intersect, then we can start asking questions about topological entanglement and how much this curve wraps around itself. In the human genome, the chromosomes are linear pieces of DNA. If we look at the chromosomes of bacteria, a bacterial cell will have a single chromosome, and that chromosome is circular. So no ends to deal with, and just one circle of DNA, also very long, that has to be packaged inside the cell.
Are they like a tangled mess, or are they packed in like neat coils? Would you describe these things as messy or neat?
Well, that's a wonderful question. So it depends. Think about the human DNA. This curve will wrap around proteins called histones and form some sort of bead necklace. And then this bead necklace, and it will coil upon itself. So it's a
coil of a coil.
It's a coil of a coil of a coil of a coil. So if we look here at the diameter of the native DNA, so the diameter here is 2 nanometers. Here, the diameter is approximately 10 nanometers. And then there's higher levels of coiling until you get to the representation that you saw in your high school biology, where the chromosomes are very highly organized and very tightly packed like that. Now, if we look at the cell cycle for a human cell, the chromosomes don't always look like that. The chromosomes look like that at metaphase, right before the cell is going to separate into two cells. But at the first stage of the cell cycle, so if we consider the cell cycle as starting here, this is what we call the G0, G1 phase of the cell cycle, or interphase. Then there is the S phase, where replication takes place. There is G2 and the metaphase. And right here, we will have cell division. If we focus at the interface, DNA is a tangled mess, but there must be some organization in there. Because if it was a completely random tangled mess, then you can imagine that the cell would not function properly. So there is some organization, but if we zoom in and look at the cell at this stage of the cell cycle, we can see the different chromosomes that look like noodles, but they occupy distinct territories within the cell nucleus. And then you're looking here, well, the question is there organization here? Is there interaction between chromosomes? Are some chromosomes more likely to be found on the periphery of the cell nucleus? Are some chromosomes more likely to be found toward the center of the cell nucleus? All those are important questions.
How can a mathematician even begin to think about this?
Well, we start simplifying the problem. We start looking at DNA as a curve. So each one of these chromosomes will now be just a curve. No sequence, no helix, no complexity other than this very long curve embedded in a very small environment. And then we can use polymer models. We can model this in the computer where the curve, instead of having a smooth parametrization for each one of these curves, we turn these curves into polygonal curves. It will be just a bunch of vertices and edges. And these polygonal curves can have these different properties, but you can imagine that by doing this, we have simplified the problem dramatically. Now we just have a sequence of vertices and their coordinates in space and the knowledge that vertex 1 connects to vertex 2, connects to vertex 3, etc. When we have a circular chromosome, then vertex N will connect back to 1, and we can put the restriction that the edges be of same length so that we have an equilateral chain, and we can put restrictions on the chain, and we can approximate the behavior of a DNA molecule using a polygonal chain. So if you have a circle like this, and then, well, it can be moving in space just by thermal motion, and we are interested in finding all conformations, not just the circle that could lay flat on a table. Does it coil upon itself? If so, how many times does it coil upon itself? Or this circle could be knotted. So the knot could look nice and fat like that, but the knot could also be a very tight knot, or it could have some coiling about it, where if you looked at it, you would not recognize its identity, but it's still exactly the same knot. So we want to explore the space of possible conformations for a given topology, be it an open circle or a trefoil knot like this one, and then apply that knowledge to the models of packing. Now, if we take a very long chain and we allow it to move in three-dimensional space, we can measure geometrical properties like the writhe, which measures the amount of coiling of this curve around itself, or we could measure the radius of gyration, which intuitively is the radius of the smallest sphere that contains this chain. If we do that, then we can apply that directly to a chromosome and think, well, what is the space that a chromosome could occupy if it wasn't constrained, if it wasn't in three-dimensional space? Well, a chromosome would occupy such space if it was in three-dimensional space. And then we compare that to the space that it occupies in the nucleus. And that gives us a measure of the amount of compaction this chain is undergoing as it is packaged inside the cell nucleus. Topological entanglement. So the cell has an army of enzymes that the moment they see a knot, they'll come here, they say, oh, look, there's a knot here. Okay, we need to break it. They open, they break, they transport